This video classroom lesson is sponsored by Transmission Bench. Visit the transmissionbench.com store for the deluxe super kit, other parts, and even the video classroom lessons used during this project.
Henry Ford is not only admired for his contributions to the automobile industry, but also for inspiration. He famously said, "If you think you can, or you think you can't, you're right." After viewing the four lessons of part one, I hope you've realized that you can at least disassemble an automatic transmission. As we move forward, I think you'll discover you can reassemble one too. It's great to have you back. This is AODE 4R70W class, part two, lesson one. If you haven't already done so, I invite you to view the four video lessons of part one and watch how parts and sub-assemblies were removed from the transmission case and placed onto another bench. The overall objective of part two is a complete reassembly of the transmission. The goals of this lesson are further separation and inspection of sub-assemblies, as well as building and using a homemade press. There were five sub-assemblies placed onto the bench which need further disassembly in order to inspect for damage. They are the direct clutch located here, the forward and reverse clutch packs, front pump, and the valve body. We'll begin with the direct clutch. Get it along with the output ring gear, shaft, and output hub to case thrust bearing and take them to another work area. As you can see, I've removed the transmission case from my workbench to make room for this step. Remove the thrust washer. There are two styles depending on transmission model. If you have the type with only one race and exposed needles, visually inspect it for damage and then replace it onto the output hub. Apply pressure and make sure it turns freely. If your model has an enclosed two-race type like this one, place it in one hand while applying pressure and rotating the outer race. It should turn freely with no chattering or indication of pitting or damage. If it does not, it will have to be replaced. Set it aside. Inspect the three sealing rings here. Make sure they turn freely. Pull up and lift out the direct clutch drum from inside the output ring gear. Set it down. Lift out this thrust bearing. Notice how this lip on one race fits into the recess in the output hub. Like all of the other thrust bearings in this transmission, it can only be installed one way. Check it for damage as we did with the other bearing. It should turn smoothly with absolutely no friction. Set it back into the output hub. Lift the inner hub out of the direct clutch assembly. Turn it over and set it down. Lift out this thrust bearing and note the protruding lip which centers the bearing in the end of the sun gear. Check it for damage like the other bearings. Once again, make sure it turns effortlessly without any chattering. This is a common failure area of this transmission, so check it very well. This one feels good. Set it as removed against the hub. Lift the bearing support washer out next. Turn it over and note the recess which mates with this ledge just above the snap ring. Set it as removed against the thrust bearing. Use a small screwdriver to remove this snap ring. Lift the end plate out. In addition to this end plate, the direct or third gear clutch pack is composed of a stack of 6 friction plates and 6 steel plates. Turn the drum over. A healthy clutch pack should simply fall out into your other hand. This is an example of a properly working clutch. The friction and steel plates appear as new. It is not uncommon to find this clutch destroyed. If the transmission you are working on seemed to neutral out and not shift to third gear, you'll probably find the plates burned black and warped. Set the plates down as removed. Remove this snap ring from the output ring gear and hub assembly. Separate the assembly. Look for bushing journal and sealing ring groove damage. This area should be straight and smooth. The ring grooves should have no indication of metal-to-metal contact with the direct drum, which would indicate extreme bushing wear. Inspect the bushing in the drum by noting how it looks and by clearance feel after placing the drum onto the shaft. It should turn freely with only a few thousandths side-to-side play. In my experience, you won't need precision measuring tools here. I've always found these parts to have perfect clearances as you see here, or obviously worn out. Further disassembly of the drum to examine the return spring cage, piston, and seals requires a press. If you'll recall, I mentioned a tool used by professionals to compress the spring cage, which I don't expect you to have access to. It's called a foot press. Because the spring tension is too high to overcome by pressing down with your hands, you must have a mechanical means to compress the cage to remove the retaining snap ring. The low-cost, easy-to-make solution is this. It's a wooden press I call the squeeze-o-matic. Let's use it to finish the direct clutch disassembly and then we'll make one together. Set the drum onto the press and center it with the notch in the wood. Press the upper lever down. The T-shaped part snaps into place in order to free up the hands to use the snap ring pliers. Push down again to release the press. We can now lift out the spring cage and piston. Notice how the lip of the outer seal points downward and remove it. Let me remind you again to save all gaskets and seals until after you are completely finished with your transmission project. You may need them to help identify new ones from the overhaul package later. Inspect the inner seal bore for gouging. It must be smooth with no damage from metal-to-metal contact with the drum. Remove the inner lip seal with a mechanic's pick. Note how the lip points down. Inspect the drum closely. A very common cause of direct clutch failure is cracking of the steel housing around the center area here. The result is low hydraulic pressure, slipping, and eventually a ruined clutch pack. Some cracks are not obvious, so we'll check again for this problem with a test using compressed air later after reassembly. For now, reassemble the direct clutch without the seals and leave the snap ring loose. Place it and the seals here on the parts bench. Reassemble the output shaft and ring gear by reinstalling the snap ring we removed earlier. Replace the thrust bearings. Set it back on the bench. Finally, get the direct clutch pack and snap ring along with the inner hub, bearing, and support washer. Place them here. Now let's build the press. Here are the basic dimensions. In addition to a few power tools, you'll also need a tape measure, square, 1/8 and 1/4 inch or 3/8 drill bits, 12 3-inch wood screws, a couple 1/4 or 3-inch diameter 6-inch long bolts or threaded rod, and 2 2x4s. Begin by cutting two 20-inch sections for the feet. Cut a 13-inch section for the back. You'll need two 18-inch pieces for the lever. To make the handle, first measure and mark a section 8 inches long. Then make a mark 1 inch from the side. Make a mark on the other side midway at 4 inches. Draw a diagonal line to connect them and make two cuts. Drill a 1/4 or 3/8 inch hole through the lever and back parts for the pivot bolt or threaded rod. Make marks on each foot for the diagonally spaced screws. Use an 1/8 inch bit for pilot holes to prevent the wood from splitting. Get it as reasonably square as possible. attach the handle the same way we attach the feet. The ram section needs to be about 10 inches long. Drill a pivot hole. In order to clear the center section of the direct clutch, we need a 3-inch deep notch, 2 inches wide. Add a 3.5 by 3.5 block to keep the feet from spreading. This completes the basic press. To modify it to lock during compression, drill a hole through the handle and install a 15-inch section of 1/4-inch threaded rod and a 5-inch long section of flat steel. Get the forward and reverse input clutch assemblies and move them to another work area. Lift the reverse input clutch drum up and off the forward clutch drum. Turn it over and set it down. Lift this thrust bearing out. Although rarely damaged, check it like the others anyway. Turn it over and set it aside. Turn the forward clutch over, or if you don't have a hole or gap in your bench, lay it on its side. Use a screwdriver to remove this snap ring. Lift the end plate out. Turn it over and set it on the ring. In addition to the end plate, the forward clutch has, depending on model, 4 or 5 friction plates, 4 or 5 steel plates, and a wavy cushion plate. When the shift lever of the vehicle is placed into the D or drive position, this is the clutch pack, which is compressed together by hydraulic pressure behind this piston to give the transmission initial forward engagement. As you can see, this clutch is ruined. It's hard to tell the frictions from the steels. Most of the friction material is missing from the friction plates, and the blackened color indicates extreme heat damage from low hydraulic pressure and slipping. This is the reason our demonstration transmission had to be removed from the vehicle. Although the truck would back up in reverse, it would not go forward. Forward clutch failure is very common with the AODE 4R70W and 4R70E transmission family, and the cause is usually one of three common but different reasons. It can be caused by low transmission fluid level. Perhaps a lot of fluid leaked out of the transmission. The pump simply starved for fluid and could not supply pressure to the clutch. Another cause is a broken clutch drum. Always inspect the drum here in the snap ring area for cracks and tearing of the metal. Repeated application cycles hammers and finally weakens the snap ring groove to the point that it separates and rips apart in this area. The result is a clutch which cannot fully apply, severe slippage, and eventual failure. Finally, the cause can be, and in this case is, from a problem in another area of the transmission which at first doesn't seem to be related to the forward clutch. Sometimes you have to act like a detective, work a little harder, and research to solve a mystery of why something in a transmission fails. The forward clutch in this transmission failed because of a worn overdrive piston pin bore in the case. Hydraulic circuitry, which applies the forward clutch when the selector lever is placed into drive, also directs fluid into a chamber between the case and the overdrive piston to make sure the overdrive band is not applied. After years of on-off cycling movement of the piston and pin, the bore becomes enlarged from wear and leaks so badly, the forward clutch is robbed of pressure and cannot fully apply. To test the pin bore for wear, use a small screwdriver and remove the clip which fastens the pin to the piston. Then insert the pin by itself into the bore and note the amount of side-to-side movement. The play here is excessive. An example of a healthy bore without wear is the reverse pin bore here. It has the same design diameter and is rarely worn because the reverse band is applied much less frequently than the overdrive band. As you can see, there is almost no play and this servo pin bore does not leak. When new, years ago, this pin bore had the same tighter clearance and also did not leak. Later, I'll show you a clever modified replacement pin included in a repair kit which fixes this problem. Now that we've discovered why this transmission failed, let's finish the forward clutch disassembly by using the press. There is a snap ring located here which must be removed. Because the ring is at a different height on this drum, I drilled another hole about an inch lower in this part of the press. Remove the retainer and coil spring. Remove the piston by simply pulling it out. Notice how the lip seal is pointing downward. Also note the damage to the seal from excessive piston travel. Use a pick to remove both the outer and inner seals. At this point, loosely reassemble the clutch without seals. Take the drum, old seals, and the clutch pack and snap ring we removed earlier back to the parts bench. Reverse drum disassembly is next. Begin by removing this large diameter snap ring, which retains, depending on model and year, a one-way roller clutch or, as you see here, a mechanical diode. It's not unusual to find it damaged or not in its groove on the drum. Set the snap ring aside. If you are working on an AODE or early 4R70W, you must remove a retaining plate, outer race, and a roller and spring assembly and set them aside. Check all of the accordion-style springs carefully. If any are broken, a repair kit is available. Later model transmissions have a mechanical diode assembly like this one. Simply make sure it clicks and turns freely in one direction and locks when rotated in the other. Lift it off and set it aside. Turn the drum over. Use a small screwdriver to remove this snap ring. Lift out the end plate and note that it's flat on one side only. Turn it over and set it down over the ring. Lift out the rest of the clutch pack. It consists of three frictions, two steels, and an apply plate, which can only be installed one way. Turn them over and set them down as removed. Use a medium-sized screwdriver and remove this snap ring. Note that it's a unique wavy type. Set it aside. Lift out the Belleville type return spring and note how it's installed with the center pointing down towards the aluminum piston. Turn it over and set it over the snap ring. There's a steel apply ring which sits in a groove on the piston. Use a pick to lift it out. Set it on the Belleville spring. The seals on this piston are not lip seals. They are a square type which rely on very tight interference fit in order to seal. You must use a blowgun and compressed air to force it out. Turn the drum over. Put the tip of the gun into this port and use a short blast of air to push it out. Place a finger over the hole on the opposite side. Look closely at the seals and notice the square cut. Remove them. Loosely reassemble the drum in the reverse order we took it apart. Set it back on the parts bench. Get the pump assembly. Leave the intermediate clutch pack and the pump to case gasket on the bench. Inspection and disassembly begins with the removal of the intermediate spring cage here. Note that if you are working on a 4R70E, there is no spring cage. Use a small screwdriver and gently pry out and up on the three tangs here. Here and here. Turn it over and make sure all nine springs are present and straight. Set the cage aside. Lift out the aluminum intermediate piston. Look closely and note how the lip of the seal flares out to seal against the bore in the pump. If you are working on a 4R70E, the piston is steel with a bonded rubber seal. Notice how fluid pressure pushes the piston and the lip from behind to seal. If a new seal is installed incorrectly upside down, fluid would simply blow by. This is how it should always look. Remove the seals. turn it over, and set it on the spring cage. Use a 10 millimeter socket and ratchet to remove the 5 bolts which attach the stator assembly to the pump body. Leave the plastic thrust washer in place for now. Lift the stator shaft up and out. Check this surface. It should be flat and free of any evidence of gouging or abnormal wear from the pump rotors. Inspect the sealing rings and their grooves. They should turn freely. There should be no evidence of metal-to-metal contact between the forward or reverse drum and this area of the support. The reverse drum bushing journal should be straight and smooth. Also, look for any unusual wear here where seals on the input shaft contact the inner bore. Do not mistake the raised areas where the ring seal for gouging. Some pumps are made this way. Lift the pump rotors out next. They should be smooth on all surfaces with no deep wear scratches. Turn them over and set them as removed on the stator support. Check the rotor pocket for gouging. This is an example of a pump assembly in excellent condition. Even the pump bushing, which will be replaced later anyway, is in perfect condition. Finally, remove the pump to case O-ring. We'll remove the front seal later. For now, reassemble the pump in the reverse order we took it apart. Leave the seals off the piston, the 5 bolts finger tight, and the return spring cage loose. Return the pump, lip seals, and O-ring to the parts bench. The last sub-assembly to inspect is the valve body. Get it and take it to a work area. The only area of the valve body to inspect in this lesson is the separator plate on 2001 and later models. Even though we'll take apart this assembly and replace many components in a later lesson, for now, look for any cracks in or distortion of the plate here in this area. Beginning with the 2001 year of production, a stiffener plate installed in earlier models was eliminated. The result in many transmissions is a cracked or deformed plate, cross leaks between passages in the valve body, and failure of the direct clutch. This is a very common problem, so inspect the plate carefully to determine if you need a new plate. If it's puffed up or cracked, you'll need a new one. Set the valve body back onto the parts bench. That's about it for this lesson. At this point in our project, clean all the parts along with the sub-assemblies we loosely put back together with mineral spirits and allow them to dry. Leave the valve body as is. We'll work on and clean it in a later lesson. I want to invite you back for part two, lesson two. We'll evaluate the overall condition of the transmission and determine what replacement parts are needed to put it back together. I'll also introduce you to the contents of an overhaul kit as well as products which solve common problems this transmission develops over time. And finally, begin the reassembly.